Tonight on this special night, it's a special show concentrating on the world of magic, where things disappear, people get sawn in half, and the quickness of the hand baffles the eye. Magic and the people who practice it have always intrigued me, and they've been practicing magicians for more than 1,000 years. The first ones performing on street corners and marketplaces with bands of strolling players. Well, today's magician is a deal more sophisticated, as you'll see during the next hour or so. First, one of the great magicians of the world, 3 times winner of the International Grand Prix of Magic, ladies and gentlemen, Fred Capps.
Thank you.
Incredible. Absolutely fantastic. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Good.
Tea.
Oh, la la.
What's the matter?
Yeah, well, you know, tails and sitting down is very awkward. Do you mind if I just put up something more comfortable?
Not at all.
Oh, thank you.
Well, that, of course, you see, that's camera trickery, and I do promise the audience, because they always believe in a show like this, it's all done by cameras, mirrors.
Yes.
So that's the only camera trickery that we'll use tonight. The rest is straightforward magic. Let's talk about the sort of magic that we saw you demonstrate up there. How much of it is due to the quickness of the hand, the swiftness of the hand?
Well, all the manipulations that you don't see, they're so very fast.
Yes.
So you do very quick movements, or you misdirect the audience.
Yes. Could you demonstrate that to me? I mean, here, as close as we are together.
Oh, you want to see a very fast trick?
I want to see a fast trick, yes. I want you to sort of baffle me.
I'll baffle you.
You will.
All right.
All right.
Let's see.
It's not difficult to baffle me, actually.
No, but I want you to look as close as possible.
Yes.
So that I don't do anything tricky. See? I got two coins here. One is a silver, and one is a Chinese coin with a hole.
Right.
Now, watch very carefully now, because it's going to happen right now. The silver's in my right hand. Now, watch. Now it's in the other hand. It goes very fast. See? Watch. I will do it again. Once more. Chinese is in the right hand.
Yeah.
When you do it, now you've got the silver here, and the Chinese in this hand. Now you think, yeah, I know you think. I got four coins.
That's right.
No, I got four holes because you see, they're just buttons. They're just buttons. Four holes. That's what it is.
That's incredible.
That baffled you.
Well, it baffled me, yes. As close as that camera was too, because, I mean, the audience are getting just a closer view as that.
Yes.
Well, that, of course, is conceivable, of course. I mean, using small objects like that you can baffle people by hiding things and this sort of thing. Can you demonstrate it with something larger?
Well, larger? How large? I always do small tricks.
Mm-hmm.
But I can show you, I have a Chinese trick.
Mm-hmm. Chinese trick.
I call it my Chinese trick, yes. And I like that. I brought it here.
I'm glad you have.
You see?
Yes.
This doesn't look Chinese to you.
No.
No.
It's a dice.
It is. Yes, the last dice. But it should be in the box. But because I have my Chinese trick in the box, I couldn't put the die in the box.
I see.
You see? Because the box is occupied.
Yes.
Yes. Yes?
Yes.
I'll show what I mean. Look, I got the box inside of the die.
I see.
You see? Mm-hmm. And because I have my Chinese trick in there, I'll show you my Chinese hit. See, this is my Chinese trick. And now, the box is empty.
Right.
And because the box is empty now, I can easily put the dice together. I put it in the box now. See? So now everything is not as it should be.
Yes.
You see? And of course, the one is inside the other.
That's right.
How I carry it.
That's right.
Of course, when I go to China, I need a Chinese dice. What? But that's not what I wanted to show you. I wanted to show you my Chinese trick. You know what these are?
Can
these
I?
Yes, of course, look. These are just...
Just wooden...
Wooden weights.
That's right.
Nothing to it.
Yeah.
I'm going to put them in a square. Right? Like that. See? There's nothing in my hand.
No.
Now, I'm going to cover these little weights. I can cover them this way, or this way, or that way, or this way. I think this is a good way. Watch very carefully. When I do this, I jump over to the other side. Huh? You like this? All right? Now watch it very carefully again. Now from there, it goes all the way over there. And when you see it here, it goes all the way over there. Now this one joins that one, and that one joins that one, so you put them all four together, right?
Why don't you come and spend Christmas with us and help entertain my children a bit?
I will, definitely, yeah.
Could you, in fact, could I entertain them? I mean, would you show me how to do a trick?
Oh, no, definitely not.
You would not?
No.
I mean, one hears this about magicians, but you would not show anybody how
to do
it?
Well, not really, no, because you couldn't do it anyway. I mean, I can tell you the secret, but what is the secret? You know, I know how to play a violin.
Yes.
You know, you buy a violin and a bow, and then you have to put your fingers on these strings.
Yes.
And then you have to strike this thing, and then you get music.
Yes.
See, I know how it's done, but it doesn't mean that I can't play the violin.
I see. Well, alternatively then, would you show me, demonstrate a trick very, very slowly?
So oh, yes, I always do very slowly.
See if I can, you didn't do that, but you did very quickly.
It looks quick. It's all in the mind.
Yes.
I'll try to find something.
But very slowly.
Very slowly?
Yes. So...
Well, you know what this is?
That's yarn, yes. Yes.
Just yarn, right? Used by, tailors?
Yes.
Right. Now, do you know the Indian rope trick?
Yes, I do know the Indian rope trick, yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Oh, I'll do something else then. we'll do something else, doesn't matter. A piece of yarn. Now, watch me very closely, and I'll do it as slowly as possible. Watch. I'm going to break it right there.
Right.
So I have a long and a short one.
Mm-hmm.
I'll do this again.
Yes.
Is this clear?
Yes, it's very clear.
Not too fast.
No, not even for me, it's not.
All right. I'll do it very slowly for you. So, what have I done so far?
You snapped it into about five different lengths.
Right. Now, you see, I go to take out one, like this, and the other ones, you see, these, oops, here they are, see?
Mm-hmm.
I'm just going to take them very slowly. Very slowly, right there, see?
Yes.
Now the thing is, I have to put the little bundle right on that thread so it hangs there. It shouldn't fall off. I did it. How's that?
Very good so far.
Yes. See? It doesn't fall off. And you know why? You see, very close, watch very carefully, very slowly, look, all the pieces are joined together.
Apart from me, who are the easiest people to fool?
The easiest people? Mm. Intelligent people.
Really?
Yes.
Why is that?
Well, it's very hard. I mean, for me, it's very hard to even fool children because they have a different kind of psychology.
I see.
See, they're more logical as grown-ups, really.
I see. So this
is true.
The grown-up gets sidetracked into sort of
yes, definitely.
Areas,
that's right. Mm-hmm. Because with children, when you put a ball with two hands, you just use your two hands, you put the ball from one hand in the other, and it's not there, it must be there. And they tell you.
Yes, yes.
And a grown up, he says, he likes the illusion.
Yes,
you know.
Yes.
And he doesn't say anything.
I would imagine, of course, that if you've got the dexterity and the skill that you've got of manipulating all kinds of things,
yes,
that in fact you make a very good con man, wouldn't you?
Oh, yes, we know a lot of con tricks.
Yes.
Oh, yes, definitely. Yes.
Could you demonstrate one of those con tricks on our audience here? Just show how easy it is
like
to...
Like three-card Monty is a little difficult, you know, to bet. You can see that on Shaftesbury Avenue, really.
Yes.
And, like on the fairground, it still happens that they don't give the right amount of money that are due to you.
That's right.
Like, short-changing.
Short-change.
That's right.
Mm.
But I can show you that if you want.
Would you?
Yes, I will.
On a couple of unsuspecting punters over there, would you?
Okay.
We're going to take
all right,
them.
I'll go over there.
Go and take their money
yes
from them.
Yeah. No, I'm not going to do that. No. Well, I go to make it very easy. Now, let's see. Excuse me. Would you mind helping me for just a moment? Will you? Thank you very much. Will you please be so kind? Just stand up for a moment. Yes. You stand right here. Thank you. And can I have a nice applause from my new assistant? Stop. That's enough. Now, who counts the money? You do.
Yep.
At your home as well?
Well, I count the money in the wife.
You count the money, not the wife?
Well, if you count the money, I count
okay,
my money.
Okay. Now, you get a chance to count some money here. Look at that. You like that, huh? Mm. Yeah, I knew you loved that. Now, will you please hold these for a moment? That's very nice. How does that feel?
Fine.
That feels fine.
Yeah.
Now, I want you to count in my hand, one by one, loud, 30, no, 11 bills. Give me 11 bills.
Okay.
One by one on my hand here. Will you do that?
One.
That's one. That's two. That's three. That's four, that's five, that's six, seven, eight, nine, ten, 11. Did he do that right?
I think so, yes.
Well, you have to be sure.
Oh, right, I'm sure he did right, yes.
See, now, you're just standing there, so I'll give you the rest of the money.
Sure. Huh?
So you have to do something to do. Huh?
Right.
And can I have my wallet?
Sure.
Because that's the way I got it. No, I'm only kidding. You gave me how many bills?
11.
11 bills. You don't mind if you verify?
Yeah.
No, because I want to be, everybody knows how many we have. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I'm sorry. Are you sure? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. No, there are only 10. Will you please give me one more? It doesn't matter, really, because I want to demonstrate this with 11 bills. You're going to like this, I'm sure. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Did you give me one?
Yeah.
Can I have, please, one more? It's a trick done with 11 bills. And that's why I asked you an extra one. So, we have now, we should have, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Sir, will you be so kind and count on my hand how many we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I told you. You see? Now, what we'll do... They're 10 now.
Yeah.
Will you please give me 3 bills? Give me one by one so everybody knows that
one,
we're not cheating. 1, 2, 3. So we should have how many now?
13.
13. Now, I don't need 13. I only need 11. You see? So what we'll do, I give one back and I give another one back.
Thank you.
So this should leave me now?
11.
11 bills. All right. 1. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I'm sorry. But 13. And if I give you two back, how many have you have?
How many do I have?
No, how many do I have?
11.
11, right.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. I only have 10. Will you please count them on my hand once again? Just give me one, just in case. You never know. All right, put them on my hand. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10. Well, this is terrible. You know, maybe you think I manipulate the bills. Huh? You think I'll do something, I fold them faster, no? What I'll do is this, watch. I put them in my wallet, so I can't touch them. And will you please count down 5 more?
One, two, three, four, five.
Nothing left?
No, nothing left.
Oh, all right. So, 10 from you and 5 from you makes 50. You get 4 back in a minute. Just a moment. Will you just pick them up and count them into my wallet? Will you please do that? That's very fine. 1, 15, you get 4.
4,
4 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Thank you very much. I need 11 bills. I only got 1. Or 2 or 3, I can't remember. You please sit down. And I always pay my assistant, so 1 for you. And I always big money. Thank you very much for helping me.
Thank you.
All I can say is I'm glad you don't work at my bank. That's what you're... Well, for the moment, thank you very much. Let's look at another aspect now of magic, and that's card manipulation. My next guest is the specialist in card tricks. He's the rising young star of American magic, a man whose unconventional skills have attracted a whole new audience in that he regularly entertains crowds at rock concerts. Last week, he won himself a place in the Guinness Book of Records by throwing a playing card 130 feet 6 inches outdoors. And if you think that's easy, well, just you try it. Ladies and gentlemen, Ricky J. You are, if you'll forgive me saying so, you are a fairly unconventional-looking magician. I mean, Fred's my idea of a magician, beautifully turned out and suave.
Well, if you'd prefer, I can change it to something more comfortable.
A dress, perhaps?
No, Michael.
No, Ricky. But, I mean, I mentioned there that you were entertaining at rock audiences. I mean, obviously, you've got the image that fits into this kind of audience. But, I mean, what kind of tricks do you use there to entertain these people?
Well, perhaps the strangest thing about the fact that I'm working for rock audiences is that I don't do big illusions.
I mean,
I occasionally work very large halls, yet I do basically small things, mostly with a deck of cards. Mm-hmm. For the largest group I've worked for recently is 4,500 people in a hockey rink in Omaha, Nebraska. Very exciting job.
I'll bet.
Yes.
Yeah. But I mean that must pose difficulties itself, because if you're doing small-scale illusions in front of 4,500 people, how on earth can the people at the back see what you're doing?
Well, it's all a matter of presence. What you have to do is convince the person in the row behind the row they're in that they've seen what's happened, and then if they laugh, the people behind them do.
And there's a little chain reaction.
Well, that's real magic.
Absolutely. Well, what sort of tricks do you do? Show us some of the tricks that you do in this sort of small-scale way.
No, I'd be glad to. You don't mind if I ask you to select a card? I know some people would think that that's a strange thing for a magician to do. I don't normally deal in such conventions, but make it a free choice and take anyone that you'd like. I don't want you to feel like I'm influencing you in a way.
No.
It's strange how long I can do this. Now, perhaps if I just proffer the cards, but maybe not. You know, some people think that I am really trying to decide what card you take. May I ask you to hold up your left thumb? Don't worry, I won't be insulted. Mm-hmm. And with it, I'm going to ask you to place your thumb into the deck so you're just opening the cards for it. Tiniest fraction of a second, and to remember a card. This precludes any trickery on my part whatsoever. As a matter of fact, Mr. Capps, I would be asking your help. I would like you to look at my eyes while Michael looks in the deck. This will prove that I'm not a thumb fetishist.
I see.
Yes. Please take a look into the deck. What I would like you to do, Michael, is to open the deck and look at a card.
I've just done so.
You have?
Yes.
God, you've moved like lightning. Really, I'm slightly embarrassed here in front of all these people. I wasn't quite ready. Did you remember the card?
I did indeed.
Would you do me a big favor?
Anything.
Forget it. I mean, I was talking to Fred, and there he moved like lightning. Let me try this again. I'm just going to shuffle the cards in. I think you have the right spirit, but slow down and give a kid a break. Fred, look in my eyes.
Yes, I look at
Michael, look at the deck and take a peek.
You ready now?
I am. Was that enough time?
It was indeed, sir.
You have seen one card in the deck.
I've seen two cards in the deck.
Remember the second one.
The second one,
okay. Yes.
Yes, right.
Do you know how to shuffle cards?
No.
Perfect.
Not like you.
Well, then go ahead. If he'd said yes, I would have been in trouble.
Just call the Barnsley fumble.
No, no, you're really shuffling the cards.
Oh, not half.
What are you doing?
You get out of it. Your trick.
Thanks a lot. I'm looking through the cards. This enables me to find the correct one. I'll tell you what, I've taken so much time with this that I'm going to try something spectacular. I'm going to try to have one card jump out of the deck and land in my outstretched right hand as if a propelled. Watch one card out of the deck into my hand, and this was, I believe, the card which you selected.
That was the first card I saw, the card you told me to forget about.
A fine job you've done, Michael. What was the card that I asked you to remember?
It was the Jack of Clubs.
Okay, watch the Four of Hearts in midair, because that's now the Jack.
Oof. Oh. You were going to say something?
I was going to say that I'm well on my way to the luckiest night of my life.
Let's talk about this thing that I mentioned in the introduction about the skill you have in throwing a playing card. You've done 130 feet 6 inches outdoors.
Outdoors.
Which is a world record because nobody has ever thought about throwing a playing card.
I would have gladly taken on all comers.
That's
had
right.
I known.
It's a hell of a way to throw it. I mean, about how far can you throw it in?
Well, indoors considerably further. I've thrown a card many times that distance, and I've been particularly interested in the aspects of cards for self-defense lately.
I mean, how dangerous a missile is that?
Well, if one takes a file and hones them to a razor edge, yeah, they can cause great damage, you know. I mean, it's really true. I was recently on safari in Africa and was able to kill a number of charging rhinos and some wild elephants. Of course, it does require a perfectly placed toss.
Yes.
Could
you demonstrate how sharp they are, then? Yeah.
Well, if you have some protective equipment, perhaps.
You know I have.
Yes.
Look, stand by.
You also have a banana? No, it's a strange question to ask an English talk show host, but...
Do I have a banana?
Yes. Is there a banana about?
We've lost our bloody banana. Oh, there it is.
It looks like a banana, doesn't it? Okay, why don't you use that? I'm going to ask you to hold the banana.
You better explain my way on these first of all, because people might think I'm a bit odd.
Actually, I'd prefer to just pause and let us both look out at the camera. No, the reason for the goggles is that these cards, of course, can cause great injury, as some of the people in the audience can now attest. And I'd like you to wear the goggles because what I'm going to do now is not, and mind you, if there are any children watching, this is not a joke. This is a very serious technique in a life and death struggle against four assailants. It is called the lethal four-card fist. Should only be used when you are attacked by four people and cannot run away or scare them. What I'm going to do is to slide back and ask you to hold the banana out.
Up or down?
One always holds the banana up.
Depends what you're educated.
If you'd prefer to hold it down, I think I can compensate with the throw.
Didn't know to be wearing gauntlets rather than this thing. The only one-armed talk show host in the world after this.
We can bring it in a little closer that's more dramatic. Four at once.
By trembling banana.
Slicing the banana. One, two, yes! Oh!
You missed.
I don't believe I did, sir. Didn't I? I think the cards all sever the banana perfectly.
I bet you didn't.
No, haven't we talked a little about the ninja assassins?
The ninja assassins?
Yes, it seems that 500 or 600 years A.D., ninja assassins from Japan developed a technique whereby if they touched a person 3 months later, they would die. Well, I have, of course, transcribed this technique and use it with the banana. Would you mind slowly peeling down the banana and see whether the internal layers of the banana have been affected by that shock?
I would like to do something on the city of the Paragogues all over the banana.
I'm glad to give you the opportunity. Very slowly and see how we're doing. I have no idea what skill it took to peel down my banana. Here's a...
You demonstrate. It seems to me that you must know more than any crooked gambler at cards.
Well, it's a very difficult thing. I imagine that I know more individual techniques because most good crooked gamblers spend a lifetime learning two or three moves, which is all they ever use in a game situation. But they learn those moves and can do them incredibly well.
Yes.
You know, and I respect their ability.
Yes. But what is the difference between you and them?
Once again, easier to demonstrate than to speak of. I would like, if you don't mind, to do... I could probably do an effect which would illustrate both.
Yeah.
The attitudes of a gambler and a magician to the same set of circumstances. I will do something which could be called in the trades controlling cards. In other words, I will show you a number of cards. In this case, the ace, deuce, three, four, and five of spades, and put them through some manipulations and still try to control. Okay? We'll start with the ace. I'm just going to place them down. The ace, and the deuce, and the three, and the four, and the five. That's the first part. Did you like it?
Yes.
It's a little subtle for some, but I'll move on. What I'm going to do now is to go completely through the deck, find the right cards, and then have them come out exactly as I intended. By the way, I might point out that I talk a lot in this trick, but when I finally move, watch out, because I move like lightning. About ready for the ace and the deuce. That's both, the ace and the deuce. Going in for number three. That's the three. And finally, to take the three, throw it out into the audience, have it come back in the center of the pack of cards, in between two cards, just two. That's the four, and that's the five.
That's incredible. That's the magician, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. The gambler would never do anything that ostentatious. I mean, a gambler's whole attitude is to hide the particular skill they're using. They would never in any way call attention to it in a series of manipulations. Rather, they would just sit around and hope that if they needed a particular card in sequence or not, that they would be able to find it. Now, I'm not suggesting for a minute one could actually do that through a series of cuts and shuffles. But if one could, it would look interesting. Now, the thing that particularly intrigues people is in a card game when cards are shuffled and they actually take the two packets of the cards and shuffle them together like this, how they might pick out any particular card. Would you mention any card at all?
Two of diamonds.
All right. I mean, the only way to do that is to actually go through the deck and find the two of diamonds. There are two ways to do it. One is to just take it from here, which is slightly interesting, proving that I have some idea of where that card is. The other is to spread the deck like this and see that every card is in perfect alignment, making my task somewhat easier.
I'm not going to a card game with you. Well, either of you, actually, because I know Fred is, of course, is expert at this sort of thing as well.
He is indeed. Yeah. But the thing is that in a card game situation, never would you see anyone use an exhibition of skill. Everything is done to make it look totally natural and exactly the way it would look if you were seeing it in a normal card game. Yeah.
There's a lot of humor in your patter that you do. Is there such a thing as a funny card trick?
Oh, show him the laughing card trick.
The laughing card?
The laughing card trick.
Yes, I like that.
You do?
Yes, sure.
Well, that's a chance for someone to laugh, yes.
Yeah.
It does have that. With your kind permission.
Of course, sir.
Yes.
Yes, the floor is yours.
Thank you, I need it. Ladies and gentlemen, the laughing card trick. That's the last.
Are there different styles of card magic? I mean, would your style differ from Fred's, say, or from some of the different...
No, people might say we're almost identical. there are very different styles, not only in appearance and in manner on stage, but simply in handling a pack of cards.
Oh, definitely.
You know, something I find fascinating. I
mean, like what? Well, I mean, what kind of different styles?
Once again, if I may. There are things that have been done. Card magic has a history, just like magic in general has a history, or any theater art has a history. The particular thing that's exciting about card magic is that it's interesting to follow a certain path. One might say that this has sort of a Spanish flavor. Look at the movement of the hands as the cards shoot forward. Something you might see Ricciardi do. I mean, doesn't it seem Spanish to you? This is just a way to get four cards out of the deck at random. I just happened to have four queens. I just happened to, but that's to me it implies a Spanish quality, and there are others. I'm not so sure. Well, this is sort of continental in some ways. Perhaps people might consider it Dutch. If you'll permit me, I'm going to try to do a Dutch version of the similar trick. I'm going to do the same effect a few times. This is sort of a startling Dutch version, don't you think? Don't you think?
I think so.
Well, he's Dutch. There's another one. You might realize, too, that this is exactly the kind of effect that would look much better if I wore a very frilly shirt. That's three. And, of course, let me give him a shuffle and find the fourth queen. And that's four. But I've always felt, I've had this feeling that I was born 100 years too late. I feel it very firmly. And consequently, what I'd like to do now is to show you how this same type of trick might have been done 100 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Ladies and gentlemen, I shall endeavor to illustrate with this ordinary pack of playing cards and to show how futile are the attempts of plebeians to enter that select circle of society known as the beau monde. And indeed to show how such entree was prevented by the polite yet frigid exclusiveness of its gentler members. Let us assume that it is the occasion of a public reception. Our table, the hall, our deck, the common herd, and we may fittingly select the four queens as representing the feminine portion of the smart set. Now, as would naturally be the case, I shall besiege these high-strung patrician ladies with attentions from the lower orders, which these next 12 cards shall represent. First, I shall place 1, 2, 3 outsiders on Her Majesty the Queen of Hearts. The next 3 commoners on the Queen of Spades. And though the mention or even notice of all these plebeians is equally abhorrent to the grand dames, I shall treat them exactly alike by placing on the Queen of Clubs 1, 2, 3 more. And finally on the Queen of Diamonds, the last 3 which have been closest to the bottom, therefore least crowding and most deserving to proffer their homage on the Queen of Diamonds. Ladies and gentlemen, as you have seen, I have brutally taken advantage of these tenderly nurtured and unsophisticated young ladies by placing them in positions which must be extremely galling to their aristocratic sensibilities. Can they endure? Can they endure?
Yes.
Yes,
yes, indeed they can. Having some knowledge of the marvelous subtlety, resources, and finesse of the sex, I feel confident these women can, with tact, and discretion easily elude their persecutors and form a more congenial coterie amongst themselves. Please watch with me. Watch first the Queen of Diamonds. Watch as she turns her back on her suitors and then goes to Windsor for the weekend. The Queen of Clubs, slightly more daring than her friends, tantalizes them, Gucci, Gucci, goo, and amidst their flushed consternation, makes her escape. The Queen of Spades, knowing the aphorism, 'tis easiest to disappear in the crowd, does just that. Now you see her, and now you do not. And finally, the Queen of Hearts. Or, ladies and gentlemen, as I suggested a moment ago, is it possible these women would seek out their own company? The fatal vanity of the sex may prove me correct. That's one. That's two. That's three.
What's the major change you've seen in that 30 years?
Well, the thing is that it had to change because of the theaters disappearing. There's not much variety left. So the big acts, the big illusion acts, they vanished slowly by slowly.
Yes.
Because you had a lot of wages to pay for assistants, a lot of animals, and, you know, you get the expenses of traveling from one place to the other, the prices are higher, and etc. So they had to change their act, so make it smaller.
The big illusion is that's been the big change. I love illusions, don't you?
Oh, oh marvelous.
Right,
yes,
right. Well, we're going to have a look now at an illusion.
A great one,
yeah. Because as we said, the real spectacle of magic is the large-scale illusion, and sadly there are a few surviving exponents of entertaining people. The greatest of the existing illusionists is my final guest tonight. He topped the bill at the Olympia in Paris during the summer, and tours America in the new year. Ladies and gentlemen, Ricciardi Jr.
Thank you.
What is the difference between a trick and an illusion?
Well, all the tricks are illusions because we give the illusion to the audience that something is going on, which actually is not going on.
You ever have a trick that went really, really wrong on you?
A trick?
An illusion that really went wrong.
Mike, tonight I almost did. I tell you what did happen to me once, Mike. I used to do an illusion where I had a trunk, a shop empty, and a girl came and danced around the trunk. Frankenstein came in, took the girl, and at the very moment he was going to put the girl on the trunk, I will fight with him, and then he will throw me inside of the trunk. It will be an explosion, and I would be appearing from the audience.
I see.
And come open, and the girl was not in the trunk, but Frankenstein. Kind of a, like a play, because I had girls, it was a big production. But I tell you what happened. We were working in Brazil, and there was two theaters, one next to the other. Like here in London, there's also some theaters like that, one next to the other. And this theater where I was playing, you couldn't, there was no way out inside the theater. I mean, you couldn't go from stage to the audience. You had to go outside the street to go in the audience.
Yes.
So I was supposed to appear in the audience and take my gun, you know, and shoot so the audience would be surprised that I'm on the audience and not on the stage inside of the trunk. So what happened? I come, there's my boys telling me, this is the way you go, go ahead, Richard, go ahead, run. So I run, I take the gun, and I go in the theater, and I go, pow! What a big surprise. I'm on the next theater.
You're in the wrong theater.
Yeah, next theater, next door.
Oh, they're doing next door, what was it?
It's a play, a very dramatic play. So it was surprising for me, for them, and Frankenstein is still waiting for me to go into the trunk.
You mentioned that, of course, working with assistants, and we saw you working there with an assistant. Right. And why are there so few women magicians? Because it's almost exclusively a man.
So few women magicians? You really mean that?
I do.
Oh, my God. It's packed with women magicians.
Really?
Oh, they make a fool of us every day.
Well, they're not, though, are they? It's exclusively.
No. I don't know why. Maybe they're afraid. I don't know. What do you think about this, Fred?
Well, I think entirely different. I think it's a man's job.
Don't say that. We're going to get kicked.
I really do. I think so.
You know?
A member of the Magic Circle and the Male Chauvinist Pig Society. I know.
I think that depends. No, I mean, depends what tricks you do.
Yes.
For instance, I do one that I know you know, Mike, that I cut a woman in half.
Yes.
All right, it looks more natural, a man cutting a woman in half, than a woman cutting a man in half.
That's right.
Yes, it's a natural order.
Although you would like to do it.
we saw there, of course, the large-scale illusion, with you know, lots of sort of staging and props and this sort of thing. Is there such a thing as a small-scale illusion? Can you do it?
Oh, yes, yes. I brought something. I wanted to show you this, because there are so many things that you believe that happened, as the elder said. No. I brought you something.
What is it?
You want to know?
Yeah.
I'll show you. Look. You know what this is?
It's a cork.
Right. But this is not an ordinary cork.
Why is that?
I'll tell you. Aldo, you know, he makes women, you know, float. Now, cork float by itself.
Yes.
Now when you put it in a glass of water, it floats.
Yes.
Right? So this is easier than floating a lady.
Yes.
No, really, I mean it. You wouldn't believe this one floats, but this one not only floats in water, but also in air.
In air.
And I'll show you very close. When you watch very carefully, you'll see the cork move. Watch very carefully now. See? That's what I meant.
Look, very carefully. I won't do anything. And you see it move. Did you see that?
Mm-hmm.
It's not the muscles of the hand at all. Look. Wow.
Extraordinary.
You like it?
I do.
You can keep it.
I can keep it. What is your favorite illusion, Anthony Aldo? Because you've invented so many, haven't you?
Oh, Mike, yes, but precisely the ones I have created or invented, I don't like it as much as one that my father used to do. I think that is my favorite one. Actually, it was not only his idea, there was a very old magician's idea, but he put it, he assembled in such a way that it became, for me, maybe one of the most exciting illusions today.
What is it that makes it particularly exciting for you? What's the...
Well, for me, this is my father's creation.
I see.
For the audience, maybe you let me show it.
Yes, certainly. Right, well, the stage is set over there, Ricciardi. We're now going to see this favorite illusion of yours.
Okay, Mike.
All right, Brian. Right.
She means she wants to see you again. Once more. 1 second, please. Okay, Rena, I'm going to shoot. Wait a minute. There you are.
Yoo-hoo!
Okay. Take it away, my friend.
I can see why that's Woo. Your favorite trick.
Thank you, Mike.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, and we're not certainly not going to try and follow that at all.
That's great.
Actually, I've got off lights now, come to think of it, but I've enjoyed the show immensely.
Thank smashing. You, Mike. Thank you very much.
Charlie, thank you very much indeed. Fred Capps, thank you too for
thank
your
you.
Contribution. Ricky J, thank magic you. Will never be the same again, I tell you.
Michael,
really, well.
If you'd be willing to help me, I might make that point come true. I was thinking of doing something.
No, I've got out of this tonight without being sorry
half
breaking like that.
Not
no,
yet,
no,
Michael.
No.
So matter of fact, would you please come with me? I might try something a little amusing. I think you'll enjoy it. Come on, step
Take
this
it.
Way.
Take Fred, you help him.
Would you like
this one? This one I want to watch from the audience.
Oh, really? Come on, we'll watch. You'll come along. Bob, you'll enjoy it.
Excuse me.
I need an extra pair of arms and legs for this one. Just come straight up. We'll go up these...
What do we do?
Up these stairs, I assume.
All right.
Michael, behind you.
Where is...
Enjoy this very much, Michael. As a matter of fact, what you have to do is go behind
this contraption
and put your head right through the middle. Just slip around the back and put your head through. Perhaps you'd like to show him. Go with the Fred, I'll show you where. You put your head in the back and it comes out.
What about showing them the contraction?
Perhaps you'd like to go in the back, Michael, and put your head through.
But they might like to see the back of the contraction themselves.
Well, all right, if you insist.
You sure?
I mean, I'm not up to that, but I will do it gladly.
Is that all right?
You can see why I was reluctant to show this, but it is soft. Splendid workmanship, don't you think, Michael?
Absolutely.
That's enough. Let's move it around, Fred. Let's move this thing around.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
So now you want me to go around the back there?
Did I say that? Yes, I'd love for you to go around the back and place your head right through the center compartment.
Shall I remain fully dressed?
Why don't you give me your coat? I think.
Your coat.
That would be nice. That would be nice. Actually, if you don't mind, Michael, would you take off your shoes?
Shoes?
Yes.
Why is that?
Well, you'll see in a moment, but I think this will make a significant contribution to the magical art. Thank you.
One is one.
Thank you.
Very insecure without my shoes off. Right, now then, what do you want me to do now?
I want you to place your head right through here, and I'm going to hook you in. All the way in. Stick your neck forward if you don't mind, and I'm sure you don't.
There's some daft shows in my time.
Good. How does that feel?
How does it feel?
Yes.
I feel like a twerp. I feel
like a twerp. Wonderful.
Oh, thank you, Dad. Yes.
Absolutely wonderful.
Yes.
Your bow tie peaks right out and it's perfect.
Can I stand up a little bit?
Yeah, stand up just
a
little.
Because I'm a bit uncomfortable.
Yeah. Okay, please do stand up just a little. And if you'd mind putting your hand through through this compartment,
sure.
That would be nice. And I'm going to tie that on. If you place your other hand through... Tie that on, I said. Fred, would you mind tying the other hand? Yeah, please do that and help me just a little. Put that on. Yeah. And your foot, if you'd mind sticking your foot through that hole. Yes. It's so much fun, isn't it? We're talking about this ourselves, how much fun. Would you mind, Fred? Yeah, we'll put that other foot through the hole.
Yeah. Sorry.
Let me see this for my... Oh, this is wonderful!
I'm glad
this is so much fun! That's great! That's very good. That's very good.
What do we do now?
That's a good question. I suppose we should pull these a little tighter, don't you think?
Hold on.
I mean, let's just stretch it out just a little. This won't be too uncomfortable. Fred, let's do the feet. Let's pull the feet just a little tighter.
That's what I'm telling you.
God, it's fun to be an illusionist.
Are you all right?
Yeah. Am I all right?
Are you fine?
We'd better go now.
No, you better.
We'll see you in about a week's time. We'll be up 6 foot taller in a week's time.
Oh,
thank you very much. Where do we now?
Yeah, take those.
Good night.
Take your hands. Yeah, we can join one.